And hey, what's up? Oh, you're already squirming.
The fun. We have a new
Excellent.
guest today, right off the bat. You might notice that Momo's not here, but we have another M Shiba in the room.
Yes.
Introduce him.
Yeah, so we have this is my Shiba, this is Miles. He's already squirming, so I'm gonna put him away very soon. But Miles is much smaller than Momo, and probably 100% as equally judgy and sassy. So I'm glad he was able to stick around for this moment, but I'm gonna send him away. Sarah, if you want to give us some news updates.
So normally Momo's here for the Momo moment right out the gates, but Momo's at the dog beach today. So once again, living her best life. But maybe you've noticed in our icons, our little mascots, we have Amabie and we have Momo and Miles. And this is the first time we've seen Miles so far. So it's a good gift.
Forever, forever elusive,
Yeah.
Miles.
And I guess, again, hajimemashite or hisashiburi, depending on who's here and who's returning. We're so glad to have you all back. Tonight's going to be amazing.
For our new viewers, if we have any new people watching Tokyo House Party for the first time, what could you tell them about what we're doing?
Yeah, so everyone new out there, Tokyo House Party, again, is a kind of party from wherever you are that happens every other Saturday from 6 to 10 p.m. Every time we have a different guest or series of guests on that talk about Japanese art and our kind of moment in the world. And then we also try to highlight other businesses and restaurants and spots and all the things happening from Japan here in our own community. So that's kind of where we're at, I guess. Derek, do you, have I forgotten something?
No, that's it. That covers all the details. Yeah, we're here to bring you a lot of cool conversations with a lot of cool and talented individuals, knowledgeable individuals about a great many things. And speaking of, do you want to let them know who we have with us today?
Yeah, we have a lot of great people with us today. And I mean, if you saw our 2 o'clock email, and if you haven't signed up for that yet, you can do that on our website, which I'm sure we will update you with if you don't know how to find that already. But yeah, we send a 2 p.m. email out every day before the show. And that gives you the whole lineup of everything that's happening. But for today, we have a lot of guests that I've been super fortunate to work with over the years here in Chicago. That are the leaders of the Japanese performance and music community. I can't say enough about them. It's going to be such a treat to have them here and share all their cool experiences. And just to start us off, I would love to introduce Tatsu Aoki. Maybe we can get him to come in.
Yep, and there we go. Hey, Tatsu.
はい、どうも、皆さん、こんばんは。
こんばんは。
タツアオキです。で、東京ハウスパーティーにね、今日呼んでいただいて本当に嬉しいなと思ってます。 And so happy to be here in the 嬉しいですね。前からね、いろんな噂は聞いてたんで、ちょっと自分でも出していただいて嬉しいですよ。 I'm so glad to be here.
We're so glad to have Tatsu here. It's really strange to introduce you in such a casual way. Tatsu is just kind of like a legacy here in Chicago of all things taiko, shamisen, dance, performance, jazz. I don't know where to begin or end, and that's kind of where we'll meander today, I suppose. But to get us started, I guess, Tatsu, would you like to, in your way, introduce yourself?
Okay. Hi, everybody. I am Tatsu Aoki. I'm actually my real name is long name. It's Tatsuyuki Aoki. で、日本でもそうなんだけど、because it's a little long to say Tatsuyuki, Tatsuyuki さん。So everybody call me Tatsu. Then, some people, I think people here refers to me as Tatsu san. So people call me Tatsu. Some people are formal, so they will say like Aoki-san, then at the dojo Aoki sensei and school Aoki sensei, but I think generally known as Tatsu. I was born in 1957 or 8, which, you know, it's very, very ambiguous information. But in Tokyo, and I grew up in right in the middle of Tokyo, Yotsuya is my home. And I moved around to different districts in Tokyo for a while until when I was about 19 years old, I decided to come over to America. And I went to LA a little bit and went to New York a little bit and decided that Chicago is going to be my second home a little later. So I did a little back and forth from anywhere from 1978, I believe, to almost 1980, kind of like go back and forth a little bit to, from Tokyo to here. Then decided that I would go to school. So I went to school. First, I went to Ohio University.
Okay.
In Athens, Ohio. That itself, I wonder about where I would go to do this intensive English, you know, courses. That then I decided that I go to this remote area in the Midwest. And so I came, in, I believe it's like 1978 that I came here in America. But I was born in, I think the easiest way to describe is geisha house in English. But it's called Okia, formerly Okia, and Okia and the Ryote. Okia is the geisha house kind of, and the Ryote is a cuisine house. And I was born in that house. And so, as long as I can remember, I was trained into dance, in the taiko and the shamisen and all this stuff all the way through high school until I got this rebellious period of time that I wanted to become an American, you know, an American something. Listen to everything America wore, everything America did, everything America did, watch all the American movies, then came to kind of study, go to school. Yes.
Yeah, I feel like, just to kind of preface for everyone out there who may or may not be familiar with a lot of the things that Tatsu's mentioning, Tatsu really leads a lot of different arts programs here in Chicago, including taiko, which is drumming. You've probably seen them at any Matsuri or festival here around Chicago. If you've seen taiko in Chicago, it's probably Tatsu and his crew that you've seen. And shamisen, which we can show you examples of all these things too. As well as jazz and some other instruments. And we'll kind of demonstrate all of this, but just to kind of give you some grounding as to the kinds of arts that, as we talk about where Tatsu's coming from, that he's looking at and exploring with the greater Chicago community. And Tatsu, I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about how you became so interested in the arts and kind of your path to really bring all these important traditions to Chicago.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you see my mother dancing on, I think that what you see on the screen there now.
Oh, yeah. With some of the shamisen,
yeah, with my mother dancing on that. So I think the music itself came with me. So I didn't really choose anything. I was born into this house where everybody was dancing, everybody's playing music, everybody is doing. So it wasn't like I wanted to do this and that. It was there in the house. So my entrance and introduction to the music was not, I don't even feel like I was introduced to music. It was there as far as I can, as long as I can remember.
Mm-hmm.
The shamisen music, dance, and the taiko was there in my house. So that's how I got interested. And I think that going into jazz music, going to rock music, going into that is kind of like I'm having this rebellious time in as a teen and not wanting to do anything traditional the way I grew up, and I wanted to do different things. Mm-hmm. So my time in the, I would say, mid to late 70s, when I was like a teen, kind of a teen, 12 years old on, there are a lot of underground art movement in Tokyo, and that came with movie, experimental films, poetry, performance, music, dance, and all sorts of stuff, and rock music as well. And everything else was kind of a turning point from late 60s in a literature too. To the 70s. So I hang out in relation to my family. Somebody introduced to me to this kind of a theatrical performing group where they were using taiko and shamisen and dance with the experimental film and a new music and poetry and everything else in the 70s, and I got involved in that. And that's when I was introduced to American and European avant-garde or experimental everything. So I kind of shift myself to, split into half. Mm-hmm. One is want to be a pop rock star. The other is to do this really strange thing that I thought, that was so weird, but I was attracted to it.
Yeah. Well, I wonder, when you came here to the United States, how did you amass this large community that you have now? I'm so curious because I feel like you're such a leader in all of these arts here. But how did you kind of become this leader?
I don't know if I'm a leader of this thing. I don't know if I am. But here is the thing. First 10 years of my life in America, starting in Ohio University, LA a little bit, and going to, New York and Chicago, I did everything but Japanese thing. Mm. So I think the people who went to college with me at the Art Institute, undergraduate study, they had no idea I have this traditional background, because I didn't do any of that stuff, and I just wanted to do like an American thing, and I rejected all this Japanese thing. The only thing I kind of liked was Godzilla movies. I sort of liked Ultraman, Godzilla movies, and all that stuff, because it was already hip in the 70s in America too. Not only now, but
Oh yeah. Yeah.
So while you were during this time period, I have a question for myself and then one a question from the audience. But during this time period that you mentioned, not a lot of people knowing that you had this this practice in music, were you still continuing on in just the privacy of your home or practicing these instruments?
No. First 10 years of my life, I didn't do any of that traditional. I didn't want to do it.
Yeah.
Right. So I did play the bass. I did electric bass. And I don't know if you people who were in that early 80s in Chicago, that I was in a new wave punk band. I had a gold head, that I dyed.
Oh, cool.
And I was playing in the clubs. Like, I don't know if people know, there was a clubs like a Tatsu, Gaspar's, and Exit, and all this, and the smart bar. Mm. Those are the places that I hang out, and I played all this music with the punk band.
Majide, do you have any pictures of that hair? I want to see that one.
You know what? It comes to think of it, I didn't show you that picture, right? But I do have it. Next time we meet, I have to show you this. Yes.
Yeah, we need this.
Yeah.
I have a question from one of our viewers, Kaoru Ayler. Yes. Says, I wonder, does Tatsu Aoki ever know of avant-garde jazz saxophonist Kaoru Abe?
Yes, we do. Yes.
They also asked if you knew of Masayuki Takayanagi.
Yeah.
Cool. Right. Is that
Masayuki Takayanagi was one of the people who were already doing sadistic mekaband in London when I was a teenager. So we used to listen to the Black Sheep. Black Sheep is the album that he's referring to.
Okay. Okay.
Mainly, right? So that's the sadistic Mika band. And it, that was one of the really interesting Japanese new rock band that was that flourishing in London. At the same time, there's another band called Flower Traveling Band.
Okay.
And they also had all these marks in Britain. Right. So yes, answer is yes and yeah.
And lastly, I guess there's two more.
So go back to Kaoru Abe. You know the influence of the Kaoru Abe. You know, I don't know if the listener know that I was Fred Anderson's bassist for about 20 years in Chicago. So mm-hmm. You know, Fred Anderson is one of the very famous avant-garde saxophonists in Kaoru Abe, and all these people are on my radar when I was younger. Yes,
that's great. They had one more, which was, and then so for, kind of a joke from our last stream was for those of you, if you're typing in caps, sometimes our Nightbot, which is handling our chat conversation on the side, gets a little aggressive. So I disabled it this time, so it's safe to type in caps. There you go. Let's see.
Yeah, they asked about a punk band that you knew of, which I feel like I have so much to learn right now. This is completely. Did it get
okay? So the name of the band is called the Fudds, F-U-D-D-S,
wow.
Like okay. Elmer Fudds.
Okay.
Yeah, and it was a new wave. It was like a new wave pop rock band.
I see. I feel like maybe it was called like the Stalin. Their question disappeared because I think that the Nightbot took it away. But it's like the Stalin, the Stallion. Maybe I'm not sure.
Yeah, it sounds about right. I'm seeing
something like that. But that being said, I wonder how this is going to take us in a completely different direction. But I now want to know, how did you feel like you were a part of like some kind of punk scene happening in Japan before you came over here as well? I'm so curious about that.
No, the scene I was in Tokyo before I came here was an underground art scene. Mm. So it was not really like that the mainstream punk rock scenes. Mm. It was very much of the experimental scenes.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
So, you know, I used to, you know, perform traditional shamisen and the taiko and the... with the saxophone and electric guitar, and the dancers were painting the whole body gold, and you know, all this wearing
it.
The masks, and you know, which I still do this in this Museum of Contemporary Art show that we produce every year at the end of the year called Reduction.
Mm.
And when you come to see the Reduction, you're going to see reminiscence of my, you know, upbringing from that. mid to late 70s experimentalism in Tokyo reincarnated in Chicago.
Okay.
Yeah, we actually have some clips later on, everyone, so you know, in the 7 o'clock hour, we'll be sharing some performances and clips and different elements from Tatsu's repertoire. So you can definitely see what he's talking about, but I'd like to see someone painted in gold. Is that happening?
No, we did, I think in Chicago, we did the in replacement of painted in gold, we did the usual kabuki oshiroi, the white paint we did. Mm-hmm. We also used the bunraku puppet guy, national treasure bunraku player, to come to play with our avant-garde musicians, you know.
I recall that one. That was really cool.
Yeah, and yeah, yeah.
I'm a bunraku fan too, so.
Yeah. Yes, I love bunraku so much. Kaoru Ayler asks... Tatsu, what you thought of Terutu Soejima, book of early free jazz in Japan? Does that sound familiar at all?
Oh yeah, that's pretty cool. And I think the book doesn't really talk about everybody up there on that time. And I can't really expect all these books to talk about everybody up there.
Right. Right.
But I think it does introduce very interesting scope of the music there. But my mentor at the time when I was hanging out with was, Toru Takemitsu. and we can't go deep into this. My dojo, where I used to hang out with all my peers to do this experimental, Toru Takemitsu and Kobo Abe, who's also literature, who wrote the stories like Women on the Dooms and Face of Another. Then Hiroshi Teshigawara, who made all this movie, they all kind of hang out in the dojo that I was in because they are friends to each other. For my sensei was friend with these people, so I got to know them. I never worked with them because I was just a little kid, you know, like 16-year-old kid learning about the strange people who's doing bamboo sculpture and installation and playing weird music and writing strange stories and making weird movies. That's all I knew. But I was part of the performing crew with all these people. Shuji Terayama too, you know. Mm-hmm. So I got influenced by all that. Mm-hmm. Yes. Then during that time, that's when I discovered, like, wow, AACM and you know, AACM is Association for Advancement of Creative Musicians, and it's a group of people from Chicago who produced a lot of avant-garde music and art ensemble of Chicago. All these people that I found out when I was in, you know, Tokyo during this experimental era, you go, wow, you know, I really want to see this. Because one of the things that it really attracted me was this. Everything else up until then about American experimental avant-garde and European are all usually all white people. Mm-hmm. And you never saw black people doing this really, really incredible performing arts until you see some people from AACM and Art Ensemble of Chicago and all these people. And they go like, so we went, my dojo people went crazy on this thing because they were wearing the mask, they were wearing the costume, and cool. They have all these instruments, and the music was fantastic. And it was something that it's a little bit similar to what Toru Takemitsu was doing that time, and we all talked about it. But they told me to go to France, and I didn't want to go to France because I couldn't I didn't think I was gonna be able to speak French. So I said, I think I'm gonna go to America, you know.
Yeah,
great.
Yeah.
I'm curious if you feel so I'm hearing a lot about some of the people that really influenced you in the underground art scene. But what about before that, with the growing up in your family, that with this rich legacy of all these traditional arts happening, did you not practice or kind of participate in those when you were young?
Yeah, I did. I performed a lot, and I did. I was going out with, of course, you know, growing up in a geisha house, you go out with the geisha girls, mm-hmm. right? And they're all pretty. They smell good and everything else. And when I was, you know, so you want my shamisen okeiko is just to see them, right? I go see them and learn this shamisen. Oh my God, you have all this picture of my childhood.
Hey, you gave them to me. You gave me these. Right.
So what you see right now on the screen, my mother, when she debuted as a geisha girl, and the grandmothers of mine, they are very scary. They are the ones who taught me how to play, how to dance, and how to do all this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are familiar with the Tokyo district, I grew up in Yotsuya, and our branch houses, which is another related geisha houses, are in Fukagawa, they're in Shinbashi and Nippori, and this geisha district in the different parts of Tokyo. So I was moving around from, you know, Yotsuya to Nippori to Fukagawa to, you know, Shinbashi, and going around these houses, and all these grandmothers, you know, they are not blood related, but they are all obachan. My obachan go there. So I go to Fukagawa obachan to do this, and the Then I loved Fukagawa Obashan because they had a pretty geisha ladies up there. Five of them. So I really loved going there and learning these songs, and you know.
That's amazing. That's, I feel like, Derek, can you just do us a favor before we have to transition a little bit? Can you put that little chibi Tatsu picture back up?
Oh, I just wait for a second.
Oh my god. We need it. The bottom.
Oh god.
The bottom left. That's so cute. I can barely take it. It's so cute. Okay,
the bottom left and the one on the top of that one is my I'm a baby, my biological father and my mother holding me.
It's so cute. So if you all can see, it'd be this on the bottom row, second to the right. That's your grandmother, is that right?
Yes.
What an amazing person. I feel like this is the most amazing photo. Can you tell us about this photo? I would love to know about this photo.
Okay, so these photos are kept in my mother's boxes in Tokyo. Mm-hmm. And I had a grant to produce a reconstruction of shamisen music called the Toyoaki, which you can buy at the Amazon.com or my site toyoakimoto.org. And so in order for me to produce this album, I needed to get these photos. So I went back to Tokyo and grabbed these photo and scanned them and gave it to designer. So this is like what you see in the inside of the Toyoaki album.
Wow. They're great. When you sent these over to us, I was just beaming, like, this is so cool.
Yeah, but I think this represents how I grew up. This is these are the kind of people that I used to see when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, now that we've looked at some things that are a little from the past, let's fast forward right to our moment if we can. And maybe we can welcome in a couple individuals that you brought with you today.
Yes. Yep.
Yeah.
Please go ahead.
We've got Kyoto and Kiyomi coming in.
Hey.
Konbanwa. Konbanwa. Genki desu ka? Genki. Thank you for
being here. Minasan, koe Kiyomi to Kyoto desu.
We're so glad to have you here. And Tatsu, Kyoto, and Kiyomi, maybe you all can talk about how you all know each other.
They're kind of like my daughters. Kyoto is my daughter.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. It seems that we're getting some feedback saying that your stream is silent in this for Kyoto and Kiyomi.
Oh, really?
They can't hear you guys.
Tester, go ahead and say something for us.
Oh, now we can't hear you.
Oh, yeah, we can't hear you now. We had you a moment.
Maybe they're becoming silent. They got frozen right there.
Let's see. Let's give them a moment because we we'll get this squared away. Good catch. I didn't even notice.
Yeah.
This is great things about the live streaming, because without these kind of things, people think it's all pre-recorded.
No, we assure you this is very live.
Yeah, very live. Yeah.
Can everybody in the chat, can you confirm that you can hear them too? Because they have such cool things to say.
Let's see.
Yeah,
the talking bonsai.
Waiting to see if the chat can hear you as well.
They still can't hear you in the chat for some reason.
I was never able to hear them. Maybe.
Wow.
Hold on. Give me just a sec. Maybe it is.
Thank you all for responding. We really appreciate you bouncing back so quickly. Help us out.
I took it out and then I added it back in. Can you see it now? Interesting. Oh, this is bizarre. Um,
But yeah. While you figure this out, everyone who's been so wonderful to chime in here, maybe if you want to think about what you want to ask them, and we can talk to them.
Yeah. Let me
see here. Well, while we're figuring out, I can talk about them. Mm. So Kyoto is one of the one of my oldest daughter, and Kiyomi is our friends, but they are the so-called original Tsukasa Taiko members that been lasting forever. So I've known them. I've known Kiyomi since she was a much younger than now, and Kiyomi has two other brothers. They are all part of our. So original Tsukasa Taiko, the evolution of the Tsukasa Taiko is that they were Kiyomi, Koji, and Kenji. That's from Negi family. And Kyoto, Eigen, and Miyumi, they're from my family. And those are the six original kids in Tsukasa Taiko. Yes, original two family. Then during the time of the evolution, we had another large family named Nitahara family, and they came with four of them. So we had this three big family making the foundation of Tsukasa Taiko. And Kiyomi and Kyoto has been such a sports to kind of ride along with the journey of my music and Tsukasa Taiko. So they've been doing a lot of different performances, and they've been doing a lot of interesting project together. So I figured that would be really, really good to have them be part of the conversation here. Yes.
Yeah. I can add too that it's rare for me to see either of these individuals without a full taiko gear and a kimono for Kyoto. I feel like I always see you in this very elaborate kimono. So it just seeing you as your normal selves is like I don't know if it's I feel like you both are more like a Superman versus Clark Kent, because your normal selves is amazing, right? Yeah.
I'm going to propose maybe we can go BRB for just a second, just so we can continue fixing our audio, because it shows up. I can see the levels from you guys, and it's showing up on our end. And if for some reason it's not making it to stream. So chat, we're going to pull the screen BRB, but you might still hear our audio, because otherwise we're not going to be able to figure out and test and see if it's working for your end. So let me just pull our cameras away.
Put up a
Okay, so here is one mic, that is me, and it is should be working still. Let's try Sarah's mic, give it a go.
Mosh moshi.
Hai, kikemasu. Let's try. Okay. Go ahead and try your mic, Kyoto and Kiyomi.
Moshimo,
Oh, they're saying it worked.
Okay, so maybe it was the backing out and rejoining that fixed it all. That's good.
Oh, they said it works?
Yep.
Yep.
No.
Oh, yeah. Wonderful. Yep. Cool. All right. We will bolt out of here and bring our faces back.
And Tatsu's back. Nighttime.
Perfect.
A little echo I should note from Kyoto and Kiyomi, and they can explain why, because they're in a studio. So, yeah, there's an echo if you're hearing in their room. They're in a big, large open space right now.
Great. Yeah, let's continue our conversation. Okay.
Yes.
There we go. Wow. We're back.
Yes. All right. Sorry, Kyoto, can we please continue? Or if there was a Sarah question that you were asking, Sarah, please.
No, I wasn't. I would just love it if you all could speak for yourselves now. So rather than me speaking for you inappropriately, so please, you all want to know where you are all coming from and all these arts and kind of how you all work together.
Yeah, so I'm Tatsu's daughter, the older one, so three. He was explaining how both of our families, we're both the oldest of three, grew up playing taiko together in the same dojo. And we have been playing together for now 20 years.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
20 years.
Definitely 20 years. And so I kind of grew up listening to my dad play music and watch him play music and go to shows and in the go see him play with the AACM members and his shows with the MCA and solo artists and things like that. And then I started, one of my first professional stage was maybe 6 or 7 years old. I was playing with my brother and my father. So
wow. That was at the Chicago Jazz Festival, I think.
Yeah, so very, I think, yeah, I was luckily, and maybe unconsciously a little bit, carrying on this tradition, this Okiya House tradition of going up on stage with your family and playing music and that form. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how deliberate that was on my father's part or my part, but it was something that I enjoyed doing, and I was doing it with my family.
Yeah.
And then also when Kiyomi's family joined, it was two families playing together. Then also learning together every week, playing on stage together and that kind of thing. So it was more of an organic, childhood activity that later, as we got older, we really understood the extent of what that means in terms of, maintaining a musical legacy, cultural legacy, this kind of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And for me, Tatsu Aoki is not my father, so it's not a familiar lineage, but I'm born and raised in Chicago, Illinois, but my first language is actually Japanese. Mm-hmm. To be exact, with my mother, who's from Osaka. And so my brothers and I all grew up speaking Japanese first, even before English, even though we're all raised in the northwest side of the city. And we all went to a Japanese language school on Saturdays. But that Saturday school that we went to it's Shitabakai Japanese, and then we explored the suburbs in our own rights. And we didn't go there to necessarily learn Japanese, but these schools are meant for Japanese families who come abroad from Japan. Mm-hmm. And it's for their children to make upkeep, Japanese schooling. So you have to people kind of know the language in order to even attend the school. So we went there for 10 plus years. And then when I graduated, I was kind of looking for something to continue on with my cultural heritage and, not lose Japanese. And I discovered taiko, and I decided to join Tsukasa Taiko when I was a teenager, like a preteen, basically.
Yeah.
And it's just been an incredible journey since then, because at first it just kind of came from a place of playing taiko with the Aokis and, like Katsensei said, the Mikaharas, and it was a fun, weekend activity that the family got involved, and it was, communal, where we spoke Japanese, we played Japanese music, and ate Japanese food together. and it was just, part of our weekly activity. But then over time, I realized the incredible stages that Katsensei would lead us to, kind of, with opportunities working with AACM musicians and other jazz legends and international musicians that I otherwise would not share these stages with. And we've been on truly incredible stages at Jazz Fest and Millennium Park. It's really amazing.
You went just a bit quiet. Sorry to interrupt you there. You went quiet for just a little.
Just your for some reason your wherever your position is in front of your mic that you share is strange.
You have to. It's because it's not in your ear.
It's not in my ear. How is this better?
It is.
Oh, okay. Well, it's a matter of me pushing in the butt. I'm sorry.
I don't own a pair of those. So I have no idea.
Sorry about that. But basically, to summarize, yes. Yeah, so I've been playing on this.
Oh, it went back out. Sorry.
Sorry, guys.
Okay, technical issues. I'm just going to hold it. Maybe that's better.
Yeah,
it is working.
Yeah, so you know, great stages that I would otherwise not be on, playing with indie scene experimental musicians as well as traditional Japanese musicians. And Kyoto and I also practice visual art in our everyday when we're not playing taiko. Mm-hmm. But so as I got older and I decided to pursue the arts and the creative industry, following, you know, college and grad school and such, I realized that Tsukasa Taiko and also Asian Improv Arts Midwest, which is our bigger parent organization that owns Tsukasa and Shuukai and our other endeavors, kind of gives me a platform to showcase, you know, things that I can't anywhere else in the world, like not even in Japan. It's something truly unique that I get to experience and exhibit because I'm Chicagoan, like I'm like a born in bred Chicagoan, but at the same time, I have this very, very Japanese native identity that, you know, is peculiar if I go to Japan, but then it's also peculiar here because I, at the end of the day, I'm a Japanese American, but we're both new types of Japanese American. We call ourselves Shinsei, where we share like the post-war immigrant families and their experiences and their stories. So,
yeah. Yeah, Kiyomi mentioned we're both visual artists. I'm actually one of my old grad school advisors is here watching, so highly.
Yes.
Yes.
So glad that they could join.
Yeah, but my father's also a filmmaker, so I grew up with, you know, projectors in the house. I was shooting on 16-8 millimeters cameras, not understanding really what that was.
Yeah.
But pressing the button, you know, and thinking that that and experimental music and experimental film was the standard, you know, the normal household.
Right.
That all parents went to the jazz clubs to play with Fred Anderson.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
My dad goes to work to play on stage with MC and that kind of thing. And then I went to art school and music. I've always kept a kind of for myself, taiko and the arts, my visual practice very separate. I think one, because I chose to pursue in a somewhat academic platform or path. And one is really something that comes from my family. Mm-hmm. However, now I'm a visual artist, but also I'm a professional taiko player. Mm-hmm. The only one in Chicago, actually.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, but and I'm able to kind of understand where these two different, I think, mediums and practices converge, and able to contextualize it and understand how my approaches to each different process influence each other or do not. But you know, my dad was saying that he grew up with Abe Kobo and Hishinara Hiroshi, and that their kind of philosophies. I think, or I understand their philosophies through my music and through my photography or film. So it's kind of funny to see them coming full circle. Yeah. Through my father, through my family, but also, you know, as an individual artist. And that's only been, you know, quite a recent discovery that I'm able to fully say I'm a musician, I'm a taiko artist as well as a visual artist, and understand that, you know, we are all these interdisciplinary, multilingual, mm-hmm. multicultural
yeah.
lives, and that it's been quite a privilege, and I'm very lucky to have.
That's amazing.
To have had that experience.
Yeah, I feel like. Oh, sorry, Derek. Please.
I was just going to say there are so many really just amazing intersections of creativity, of sort of past and present, and you know what's to come after that. That it's almost I'm like overwhelmed by which yarn ball to tug the thread on conversationally, because I just want to know about so many of these different topics. But most presently, you talked about both of you talked about being visual artists as well as practicing taiko, and that some of these moments there are, or exploring how these two things may or may not intersect. Has there been moments for you recently where there has been a deliberate exploration of both of these things, where visual arts and taiko have been showcased on stage together?
I think that's recently I was in a group show at the Cultural Center. It's a third iteration of the show called Living Architecture that was part of 6018 North.
Okay.
And now it's called Influx, and it's a Cultural Center iteration, Influx Chicago Artisan Integration, which has since been closed to the public since mid-March.
Right,
but the work is technically still up, and it's myself and about 50 other Chicago-based immigrant, first generation, second generation immigrant artists.
Mm-hmm.
And I have visual work there, and I made site-specific photographs for the Cultural Center iteration, mm-hmm. Responding to the exhibition hall where the installation is up. But for the opening, I played the curator, Trisha Benek. She asked me to play taiko because she knows of my taiko background. And so and it was the first, or she asked me to play actually within the three shows that she curated, but it was the first time really that I presented myself as a taiko artist as well as a visual artist in the same context.
Oh, wow. And
that was quite new.
Yeah.
And yes, I think I'm okay with it.
Yeah.
I feel like you're kind of a testament to something that we spoke of earlier before you joined us, I believe. But I mean, some of the ways that I've known all of these amazing people here is through working at the Culture Center and the Arts Foundation here in Chicago, but also for the at the Art Institute of Chicago. And this last year, they decided to hold a Lunar New Year festival instead of Chinese New Year festival. And they're like, Sarah, because I'm the only person in the education department right now that focuses on this. And they're like, Sarah, what should we do? And I'm like, you have to reach out to Tatsu and all of Tatsu's crew. And they were like, well, we want to make sure that there's women involved. I'm like, that's not going to be a problem.
We're women.
Yeah. And so I wonder if you all and Tatsu, maybe you want to chime in about how, as you were talking about earlier, if you see taiko groups in Japan at Matsuris and things, it's lots of men without shirts and without a lot of clothes. And here in Chicago, it's a little different, a little different.
Well, I think in America too. I would say our friends. I've been a friend with one of the originator of the North American taiko culture, PJ Hirabayashi. She was the first one actually to bring in the all female drummers with a really interesting costume that she designed, and. I remember many moons ago when I was when we were producing Chicago Asian American Jazz Festival at the MCA, I brought PJ and her drummers into MCA to have the big band orchestra with Anthony Brown. I don't want to take that credit. I think it's really belong to San Jose Taiko for that kind of a female. But my take about it is that I grew up, like I said, with a lot of geisha ladies. So I have a different kind of attachment to performance with kimono and the different costume. And my sensei was totally that because he completely segregated this idea of festival matsuri taiko on stage taiko. And we were told from our scary sensei, said it's a crime if you try to bring in the matsuri taiko on the stage, it's a crime because they belong into Matsuri. Don't ever try to bring that on the stage to think that you're going to have the same thing. You know, so I had that influence, and also, you know, looking at somebody like a PJ, the Sound of the Tycoon, I'm always kind of interested in this idea of having a lot of a female drummer, because they can dress completely differently. And I so enjoy, because we have a program with Fujima Ryu of Chicago, the Japanese dance shubukai. And Fujima sensei is our kimono consultant for all of our performances now. So I get to have both taiko art and also this really interesting costume changes. And my taiko group, where I came from, if we played 8 songs on the show, we had to change our costume 8 times.
Oh, wow.
We, you know, in mid to late 70s, we never wore same costume in song to song, and that was his policy. Wow. Not everything different, but different happy, different shirts, different hachimaki, or different, you know, but there's some changes between the song, and I try to keep up that tradition with all of them. So yeah, Yomi and Kyoto, they're running around in the back, changing.
Yeah, I think it's a different understanding of like the spectacle of the stage and the presentation, where you know, that's the maybe stereotypical archetypal presentation of Matsuri Taiko is really this muscular men playing as fast as you can, and that the spectacle really is in playing as fast as you can, as hard as you can, as loud as you can. Where for our group, it's really about musical complexity and choreographic presentation, which is actually part, choreography is part of music and the phrasing. And so that's where we would like to kind of
differentiate ourselves.
Yeah,
feature.
That's like, that's the highlight of the performance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And of course we look presentable with kimono and things, but there are other ways to present, I think, powerful music without playing loud and fast and strong and half nude all the time.
All our performances, like even in like the hot summer days, but especially our annual concert at the Museum of Contemporary Art Chicago in December, we meticulously plan out the costume changes, but also like the visual presentation. So we have the physical element of like the choreography and the percussion and the music and the fluidity and the relationship with every guest artist and like all our, you know, youth performers and everybody on stage. But we also kind of orchestrate how it's going to look to the audience, you know, from like start to finish, and everything is completely pre-planned and pre-designed. You know, to fit like the theme or the concept of like the show or the sensibility of the new song that we learned for the year. So, and that's something that you might not necessarily see when you Google taiko drumming on, you know, YouTube or something, because you'll see all the high speed, muscular, holo style, super Hollywood entertainment productions of taiko. And then we just want to always emphasize the fact that that's not what Tsukasa or Aaron W is about, and we're okay with it. And you know, some people get that, some people don't.
Yeah, I feel like someone earlier had said that they'd seen you all about. I wonder if others in the crowd here have had the luxury of seeing exactly what they're talking about at different festivals and events. And someone said they saw you at Mitsuba before. So I'm not surprised. Yeah, if you all haven't seen them out there, by the end of the show, we will give you a lot of ways you can still connect with them and see them now, even from your home. So don't fret. There's lots of ways to connect with this group of people. So
yes, keep an eye on the chat. Our chat bot will be providing links for not only where you can find Asian Arts Improv, but Taiko Legacy and everything that you'll be seeing on the show. So just have a look out there. Speaking of all of these all of these different things that we've talked about, these performances that we've talked about, we've also been intended on showing a couple of these, right? And I was curious, Tatsu, you mentioned a small handful of ones that you were interested in showing the audience and being able to speak on. And I wanted to ask you if there was any one of those that I could show first, and then maybe hear back from all of you about you know, the performance and everything.
Yeah, so I think I will try to do this with the most deceiving one. we really take a pride on this. What Kyoto and Kiyomi was talking about is that music, the components of the musicality of our songs that are a little bit different from what goes on as a most popular style of taiko drumming today. But they are very similar. So if you don't pay attention to it, you could not see it. But so there are obvious ones, and there are not so obvious ones. So I want to show you this song called Izumi Daihachi.
Okay.
Yeah. And it's one of my favorite songs. The way we come into the song is a little bit unique. And I think Kyoto and Kiyomi can join talking about that. So let's look at the Izumi Daihachi for a couple.
Izumi Daihachi. Okay, great. Give me just a sec here. It looks like my stream is doing a lot of heavy thinking. So once I have kind of control of it again, I can switch things over. Let's see. And we can get that loaded up.
Photography Banzai, we got our answer.
Yes, I think for the Anderso Garden, we bring our kids group, right?
Yeah.
We are at Mitsuwa for the summer festival, just because.
Yeah, at the Mitsuwa, we bring in our kids and the group, yeah. Because, you know, it's very, very interesting because there are certain parts of the city is very territorial with the other taiko group from other event, and we don't want to go marching and do all this, you know. So they have different taiko group performing, you know. So that's I think Anderson Gardens or Hoetsu, which is it's very interesting because Jason Matsumoto used to be in our group as well. So we're friends for a long time. In fact, first round of the Miyubi project, I think Jason and Ryan, who are in Hoetsu, they were on our combo. So we're kind of friends to each other. But to answer that question, yes, Anderson Garden, we bring in our shamisen, we bring in our kids.
Great, great. Okay, and that's Izumi. It's about 3 minutes, so I will play that here shortly. For us, us here in chat, we will go dark on the microphones for just a couple of minutes so that we don't interrupt any of your viewing. And here you go. Let's see. Chat, can you see this video okay?
I don't think it's there.
Oh, all right, hold on. We'll pause this. This is quite the tech day. All right, one sec. We will save all of this. Let's see. Yeah. All right. I wanted to make sure that they were.
But you know, don't worry. It's always PG here. You won't catch us saying too many wild things.
No. Yeah. Our mics are on, but we won't be saying anything. Let's see.
I will say right now that. Can we get Boss Coffee as a sponsor? How does that happen? This is my favorite one. we've been talking to Suntory. We need Boss Coffee now. I'm just gonna out there.
Oh, wow. Are they sponsoring the event, Boss Coffee?
No, but I want them to. Aoki said I want them.
That would be amazing.
I'm panicking.
Is that the Amai Coffee? Amai no?
Cold. It's a cold brew.
Oh, but it's Amai sweet? No.
Yeah. No, it's black.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Ah. Okay. Yeah. I think we're in good standing now. So, let me push the screen over to all of you. I will. Okay,
mute my mic now.
Yeah, we'll do that now, so you won't have any feedback from us, hopefully. And let's get looking. Oh, it is just a teal screen. Yeah. This is
like, I don't think it's there.
Oh, okay. Chad, bear with us for just a moment here. We tested all this and here we are. Let's see. I will switch over to another slide and switch back because sometimes that will bring it to life.
And kind of just reminder, if you have questions for Tatsu, Kyoto, or Kiyomi, or Derek, we are here for those too while we kind of load and unload things.
Unpause source previews.
I wonder if while we kind of arrange things, Tatsu, Kyoto, and Kiyomi, I wonder if you could tell us, can anyone join your group, or how does one learn Taiko and Shan?
Oh, we have, we have a periodic workshop for people,
mm-hmm.
and they can come to the workshop for a while, and we'll check and see if they are, they would like to join us, then we will invite you to. So basically, we don't really, we have a full members right now. I think all members that we have are probably almost 60 people.
Wow.
And they are consistently the performing members, but we do have a workshops. Mm-hmm. So you come to the workshop for a while, then spend time with our performers, then if you like, then you can join the group.
Thank you. That's really informative. And it looks like maybe we have it figured out. Ooh. Yes.
I think it's here this time. I had to just I didn't do anything different except just reload the same thing over and over.
It's a god, Derek.
Yeah. So, okay, this time without interruption, let's share this video with you. I think even if just because of the format of screen sharing and it all coming from just my computer, you may hear some of our mics anyway, but we are just going to try and keep it as quiet as we can. All right, here we go.
They're saying they don't have sound, Derek.
No sound? Okay. Oh, this is brutal. Let's see. Alrighty.
Well, all the performers that perform these songs, they can do the kuchishoga, they can sing the song.
Let's see. This is quite the challenge here. So this one is showing screen share. It should be picking up the audio because I can see the beat from it. Let me try and play with one other thing. Communications. Alrighty, let's see.
Derek, we also have someone commenting, if you have a what you hear option in the video source, it would pull from the footage playing.
Yeah, that's the thing. So it's specifically this to kind of ramble on about the stream app that we're using. Specifically, we're using Lightstream, which is a browser-based streaming service that has its conveniences in pulling guests into the channel. And while the audio mixer here is granular enough that it shows all of my different outputs and I can have control over them, it is clearly not the same for the viewer side, because I see all four of our mics. I see my mic here, and as well as the video output. All that to say that it's leaning me to switch back to some other services that I've used previously for their ability, their capabilities. Let me see here. Okay, I'm going to suggest going to BRB just for a second while we take care of a few things. So sorry about that, chat, about the inconvenience, but we'll be right back.
in language, and so all the artists that we've chosen to showcase, you know, we all speak the language, we all grew up in bilingual households, both of our grandparents are in Japan, and so we travel back and forth, and so our artistic practices are less about, and they're not really so much about an investigation of our cultural backgrounds per se, you know, and we're not really looking to make work about exploring the motherland and things like that that I think often happen for maybe third or fourth generation Asian American artists. But ours is really, you know, I'm a photographer and filmmaker, and I'm more interested in material processes. And we had an artist from New York come down, and his is more textual, he's a printmaker. And so certainly our works are influenced aesthetically, and I think more philosophically than a didactic kind of exploration. And so that's what the show is about. And we'll talk about that in the panel discussions and such. So if you...
This is the first, sneak peek. First listen to everything that we're going to discuss, everybody at Tokyo House Party tonight.
Yeah, very cool. Very cool. We're grateful for it. Seriously, yeah. This is great. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I think one of the things is that relate to what Kiyomi and Kyoto is doing, that at the same day, I think I'm doing my new quartet. Mm-hmm. And my new quartet is not like a movie project. It's more of the electrically charged band, with two electric guitar and electric bass and the drum, which is a new idea for me, which music doesn't really go to this ethnic identity. It's more about this particular music that I listen to and how it digested into, you know, 62-year-old dude in Chicago.
Dude!
Yeah, how it's being processed. And,
yeah.
Yeah. Very cool. Thank you all for those really thoughtful responses to our questions. I know everyone really appreciates all those insights too. You're like I said, I never know where to start and end with you all. You have so many things happening and contributing so much to our community. So thank you. And Derek? Well,
I think, you know, it boils down to representation of how we present who we are. And who we are is, myself is a new immigrant, and Kyoto, Kiyomi's generation, and they are second generation immigrant. And this is all post-war Japanese community and Japanese American community that are slightly different from the existing Japanese American community. And we try to figure out the way to represent that idea of being who we are in that way. And of course, the merging point is we do play taiko as well as everybody else does. And we do the shamisen, we do the dance. But I think what we are about is really, we are the post-war immigrant and the Japanese. So new sets of the Japanese culture in Chicago is something that we're interested in.
Thank you again. And Derek, I'm happy to continue our conversation, but I just want to bounce back to check in if we are able to watch a clip.
Yeah, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna do this in two parts. So I had to switch. I had to switch how we're streaming this because the original screen share option is, I guess, a little finicky. So chat. Wait, can y'all hear me?
Maybe they can. Maybe not.
Can you both hear me?
I hear Derek.
Oh, weird.
Okay.
Oh, it's cool. but wait, but you guys can't hear me though. I guess they can't. No, that's crazy.
You can't hear Derek. Weird. Oh,
wow, weird. Because I hear him.
Yeah. Wow.
This is madness today.
Sounds like the chat can hear you, Derek. So at least. I can translate if need be.
What I'm going to do, two parts. I'm going to switch over to the screen that has the video. And if you could do us a favor and let us know if you can first see it.
I just remembered, Sarah.
And then second to that is...
Just one second. Sorry, Derek.
Sorry.
Second to that is... Chat, if you can... Once you can confirm that you can see the video, I'm going to play it. And then let us know if you can hear it, because that is a need as well. So here we go. Let's switch over. Fingers crossed. Wow, that was amazing.
The production of these videos too is so awesome. It really helps to see like what's really happening here Wow.
And chat, thank you for sticking through with us through our audio and stuff like that. I'm glad we got a chance to present that on screen.
So I think going back, I think that was that would be one of the most deceiving one that I think. It's kind of tricky to understand how that is different from the other kind of a taiko group. But I think musically they are very, very different but stylistically very similar to what the norm of most popular taiko music. And in the history of the Tsukasa Taiko today, the songs that they are playing is of course the songs that I used to play when I was younger. And my group and my sensei completely went against the mainstream taiko group happening at that time. You know, so he didn't go with what was most popular at the time, and we went different way. And because of the underground arts movement, we as a youngster, thought that was cool to just go against the norm.
Mm.
And that's what we were doing. And to me, it is incredible every year, every time I see Kiyomi leads all the group to the people from our group to play these songs, because it's something that I used to play when I was young and reincarnated in Chicago of all these places. And it really, really amazes me and it moves me all the time.
I always think if we had a time machine, that would probably be the first thing I would personally do, to go back to 1970s Tokyo to see a young Tatsu sensei doing the pieces that we learned from him. And I think it would be, just because we don't have the opportunity to meet the, you know, his colleagues and his theater troupe mates, if you will, and his senseis, moving forward. So I always wish, how magnificent it would be if we could meet somewhere in time.
And my sensei did not believe in photographic representation. So no photo, no film, nothing was taking place. And all we have is my transcription of the songs, which they go by.
We reinterpret them.
Understand them now. It's the same with Eido. I was, before we had quarantine, I was taking Eido, and very much the same of no photos, and I can take any notes that I can personally, but that was about it for the practicing the art. That's amazing. Kyoto Kiyomi, can you hear me now?
But I think what's interesting about what you're saying, Derek, and that I think is kind of important to this conversation, is that all of these traditional Japanese arts really share some of these common core threads in terms of practice and how tradition is carried along or not carried along. And so Kiyomi and Kyoto, I don't think you could hear Derek mention that he was taking Eido at the center as well. And same for his classes there, that could only take notes but couldn't film or record in such a way or take photos. So I think it's interesting you're all saying the same things and that these traditions feel similar in some ways. Well, we can, is there more that you'd like to chime in about that particular clip, or would you like to jump to another one?
Yeah, let's jump to another one. And I think one of my favorite work for me to see them play is a song called Karami. Let's play. I mean, we don't have to, it's up to you. We can play the whole thing, or we can just stop and, talk about the music, or whatever you like to do.
I personally would love to show the whole thing.
Okay.
So let me make sure that I have the right link, because now I'm working off these links here. But give me just a sec. If you could, while I'm pulling this up, if you could give our audience kind of a heads up to what they're about to see and what Karami is all about.
What they're about to see is Karami っていうのはね、あの日本語で絡むっていうのはね、to kind of, like when you get a drunk, you get a little rowdy, right? then you start to say, like, you start to have all these things, little twining with the people, right? So one of my member, Kayano-kun, was notorious for being drunk and starting to do all this weird stuff and say all these bad things about the people. So we made the song about that. And so it's really about intertwining the sound that comes from all over the place and also the body that moves around. So
that's great.
It looks like not unified, but it is unified. And it's a very, very complex piece to play. And I can't, let me tell you to the audience, I can no longer play these songs because my I would not remember all this stuff, but they do. I only teach them how the music should sound like and how to look. They remember, and sometimes they make a new arrangement to this choreography, which is the way the real tradition should be carried on. That's right. Amazing. The next generation has to interpret the way. So I think what's interesting about that is that the fluidity of the traditional passage is very important to me, because it's not the manual that you read and always the same, but the some arts like a kabuki or other baroque classical, western classical music, they would go with that tradition of executing exactly the same way. And I think one of the audience that asked me about the shozo sato, and have I ever communicated with the shozo, I think shozo sensei's idea was to have that rigidness into the traditional and rendering it to the new western thing. My tradition is very similar, except a lot more freer. So I would let the new generation to actually change it, and I would be okay with that, you know. So that may be a little different from, because we have a discussion with our guest performers from Japan. Some of the Nagaota classical musicians are there, really like a square, straight ahead, you know. This it has to be this way, and we try to incorporate that idea into this real fluid thing in the 日本語でね、このいい加減って、いい加減ってなんて言うんだろうね、あの英語で。
Like a little rough.
Yeah, yeah. でね、そのいい加減、いい加減だよねっていうのはね、you're like, what is it? You're not,
Not as careful, not as
that's kind of like, you know, when you're not together, you say like, yo, いい加減なこと言ってんじゃないよ. But if you break down this idea, it's いい加減なの. いい加減なんで, it's a good application. っていうインタープレテーションがあって、That's what Chizuru sensei says to me all the time. I say like, oh, I'm just doing this いい加減 thing, and Chizuru sensei always said, no, それはね、いい加減なのよ。だから、it's not really random. And she's right. It's not a random thing. You know, it's like I talk about the improvisation to people, because sometimes people think like, oh yeah, improvisers doing their free thing, but it's not really, it's free thing, but it's not really free, because improvisation, this whole idea of improvisation, traditionally called mawashi or tama it's controlled. You have to know exactly what you're doing to be able to improvise. So karami represents this randomness, but it's really, really complicated. And it's very, very coordinated. And I am really so happy to have these young people play this thing. So like great. I said, I won't be able to do it now.
Great. Yeah. Okay, chat. Please have a view at Karami. It is about 7 minutes long. So there's some really great stuff to see here. And let's take a look. Very cool. Wow. Okay. That was amazing. I really love all the different components that that performance had. There's so many layers to it.
Yes, it's a very, very complicated ideas, and I during the 80s, when I just about started to think about the Miyumi project and evolution of my contemporary jazz music in Chicago, I also started to transcribe a lot of the songs that I remembered from that time. And Derek, I just sent you a PDF file that, so all these songs that Kiyomi in Kyoto and all the members of Tsukasa Taiko, they are transcribed into this old notebooks. It looks like that.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I'm going to get this up for chat.
I love that.
Yes. And I have books and books of these things.
Also, everyone, there was a question from the chat that I'm also curious about. They wonder if there's a significance to the placement of your drums and your instruments.
Yes. Each of the songs have a different. I draw guidelines of this is what the song, the concept of the song. Yeah, were we answering one of the questions?
There you go. Yeah, if you could jump back to answering that question. Yeah, I created a new scene to add the image there, and I needed to add the microphones once again. So
right. Yeah. So there is an original idea of the song. So depending on what song we play, I have original ideas of how the drum should be laid out. Then. Logistic thing is a little bit different sometimes. Sometimes it matches that I draw something and Kiyomi and Kyoto interpret and bring it into the stage exactly the way it is. But sometimes logistically it doesn't work. So then Kiyomi and Kyoto work out together to have it so something that is really close to the original idea. And it's been translating really well. For Karami, it's deliberately put the taikos laid out that way, sort of randomly, so that you can see the body movement that in the different formations. Yeah, and there are ones that like Izumi Daihachi is really formatted, you know. And yes, so answer is yes, and it's a old idea. Of course, the original Gintenkai. My group was only about 8 people. And so with the dancers and everyone, maybe I would say like 12, 13 people performing together. Mm-hmm. But Tsukasa Taiko, we're looking at 20 plus people together. So it's expanded into bigger space.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's 60 of you total. I had no idea. That's wild. Amazing.
Well, you know, 60 members, but I think on the Taiko Legacy, maybe 30, 20.
Yeah, and our performance unit is about 20.
I see.
Yeah. Well, because in Taiko Legacy, we have our sister dojo in San Francisco. So we bring in about 8 or 9 from San Francisco and our Chicago performing crew put together, plus our guests. So I would say like 28 people. Performing together in that.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow.
We do this exchange with our sister dojo, Genryu Arts, who are based in San Francisco, and we've been doing it for over 20 years because I think like the first exchange members, they were like 4 years old when they, one went to Chicago and the other came from San Francisco and this and that. But so collectively, we're the premier performance unit drummers that formed this collective national gintenkai between SF and Chicago. And there's, right, like Kyo said, there's about 20 of us. Some of us are in Japan, some of us are in the Bay Area and the Midwest, but then we always kind of converge for Taiko Legacy, although we do several exchanges throughout the year, usually like one in spring, and Kyoto will go out to teach something, and then someone from their group will come here to acquire something to teach back, and then we kind of have this back and forth, of course, you know, pre-COVID days. But it's a, yeah, it's a great experience because, again, all those family members in San Francisco, they, we all kind of grew up with them too. They're like family friends, but also, you know, outside of this interaction with RMW and Tsukasa Taiko, they might not necessarily be, you know, Taiko artists per se, but then they have the skill set and they have this knowledge and they have the oral traditions and everything that they've learned over the years. And their dojo is led by an artist and master sensei, Melody Takata sensei, over there. So she leads their troupe, and it's her younger students who used to be, you know, under 10 when they started, but now they're all in their 20s and yeah, like late 20s, early 20s. So they're able to do these premier performances, and they're kind enough to sacrifice their summer vacation or take, they'll, even if they're working, they'll take a week off to come out here to learn these songs with us and keep this legacy going on. So we're very grateful for, of course, you know, their collaboration and willingness to contribute to our arts and keep the practice going.
We're grateful too. I want to note that we have about 10 minutes left before we welcome another extremely unique and special guest. So we could maybe do one more clip. And just to note that we will have another bit of time after our next guest. If you all still wanted to be around and we could chat more, it's up to you, no pressure. But if there are more questions, we're here for that too. But thinking about how to best, you know, drill you for the last 10 minutes that we have now, what would you like to explore next?
I would like to show maybe a little bit, 3 minutes or 4 minutes of the song called Suji.
Candy.
Yeah, then we'll kind of talk about this, yes.
Yeah.
Let's do that. I will pull that up. Let me see.
There we go.
Kyoto, Kiyomi, can you hear Derek now?
Yes, he can.
Okay. Oh, what a surprise. I don't know when that, I didn't do anything. okay, great. We are going to show a few minutes of Suji here, and then we'll have a bit of a chat about it. So I hope you can look forward to it. Let's see. Here we go. Thank you. Okay. That was, yeah, I can't wait to watch the rest of that. Very cool. So what can you tell us about Tsuji and what went into that?
And note that, Tatsu, your mic is muted.
Okay, so I want to mute my iPad too so that we don't feedback here. Tsuji is one of the once again, it's one of my favorite songs to watch. I was in the late 70s, I was the guy who plays a little time with shime taiko, small taiko on the floor while everybody's doing that. Which on this version I eliminated that part because you know, it just didn't really fly well with the arrangement of the stage. So I took myself out of this. But the idea is that each of the person have its own orchestra of three different sound of the drum, and they are playing the melody with that. And melody line travels around. And I think six of them are playing in this version. And very, very, very exciting piece. And, you know, I'll let Kiyomi and Kyoto talk about this.
Okay. well, this one, okay, so we've done several iterations of Tsuji. Actually, I think the first time we played it maybe was 7 years ago, 2013, I want to say, something like that. And it was the original core members of Tsukasa Taiko, the foundation, which was the Aoki, like Miyumi, her younger sister, and Kyoto, and myself, my younger brothers, and
actually Jun,
Jun-san, your next.
Oh, cool.
yeah, Jun-san and Noriko-san, who's our international residency instructor from Japan, and we presented part one, and then the following year, in succession, we presented part two, and this is the third time we're presenting it on the MCA stage as a full piece, but we feature the ladies from Genryu Arts, our the other half of our national Gintenkai unit that we just spoke about 5 minutes ago, and it was the first time playing the piece for many of the girls. Actually, one of the girls who was following Kyoko's part, Mari, in the back. This was her debut stage for Taiko Legacy. She's like 16 or 17, and she debuted with Tsuji, which is piece. Incredible. So, yeah, and she did great, a very complex piece. So it's a culmination of, you know, our artistry and our efforts and our practice and our collaboration. It's definitely like a pinnacle presentation of that, where we were able to, because we really practiced together only like 2-3 times a year, and everything else was just kind of on our own. And then we had the week, of course, before the presentation, but through it all, we were able to excel and come together and show, you know, what Genryu Arts and Gintenkai and Tsukasa Taiko can do. But the music itself, like Tatsu-san explained, it's also really, really interesting because there's all these movements and small repetitions, but it's not like cyclical, would you say?
Yeah, it's not repetitive. I think the one Tsuji phrase, Tsuji means line, or kind of the idea of like the core, the support.
Or the system, spine. The spine. Or,
The Tsuji line is when we're moving back and forth like this.
Creating like this wave, this
kind
movement.
Of, yes, that's a kind of cyclical one line. But this piece, and you can tell, like, if you've seen Kodo or other, like, mainstream, let's say, groups who use multiple drums, this idea of using more than one drum per person is a modern idea and concept. But oftentimes, you know, it's about playing, again, as much as you can, as fast as you can, as many times as possible.
Very athletic, very percussive.
Yeah. I mean, I think this piece is a beautiful job of balancing the multiplicity of the drums. Everyone has three. I'm in showcasing them all in different stands. They have the high angle stand, you have the skidoku stand on the left, and you have the more standard flat stand. Balancing that with the choreography and the music. And so it's actually quite one of our more complex songs. So the music itself is very intricate within the 3-4 parts that we're all split into. And then the choreography and matching the timing and things like that. So I think it's quite entertaining to watch, but it's also a highly conceptual and intellectualized piece around this idea of this through idea of the through line, which is the dōbō 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 that you kind of hear reemerge throughout portions of the piece.
When I think what's really cool is that you all, like, the through line is felt by us all, and it's done because you are all such amazing musicians and performers, but also I feel like this is not something we mention often, but you're like athletes, right? Wrong. And like, momentum, and I've seen you all perform in the dead of summer in the Culture Center where there's no air conditioning. You show up, and I am just amazed. I mean, I think I would pass out for sure. I mean,
there's a when we first learned this piece, like originally like 7 years ago or so, I asked Tatsu Sensei, "Oh, what is Suji about, or like what's the title behind it?" And he told me, like, "Well, you know, there's a phrase in Japanese called Suji o Tosu, which literally means like to pass down like the core or like that spine or the straight line." But the not the literal translation, but the interpretation means is to.
I think it's like the maintenance of traditional ideologies and heritage. And so, or at least that's how I interpret it, and that we're carrying on these traditions through these pieces embody, you know, dance and musicality, as well as technique.
Like, yeah, definitely. And it also keeps, like, it kind of refers to the term of like keeping grounded or keeping like your head on your shoulders, like doing like the right path. Like, that's what Suji o Tosu means. Like, if you do, you know, if you do something, let's say like criminal or illegal, it's like, oh, you're not Suji o Tosu tonight. Like, you've deviated from the path and you're not on this like righteous spine or like the core. So he explained to me that it kind of has something to do with that, where you have all these three drums and you can play, you know, up to six faces, and you have all these choreography where you're spinning and stepping back and stepping out and this and then, but you always come back to the center, or the core.
Yeah.
So if you don't have like a good core, you can't play this piece to begin with, because you have to kind of physically too, right? Like, be grounded, and you have to be at the right angle in order to play. You have your arms stretched properly and have the right wrist movements to hit the drum and make the loud sound, because otherwise you're going to hurt yourself. So I really resonated with that, because it came back around to so many different meanings, like about how Tsukasa Taiko and also really Genryu Arts treasures the fact that if you can't play like all the traditional basic things first, you cannot deviate and do all these contemporary interpretations and activities if you don't have that traditional understanding and foundations. And all of us do in Gin Tenkai. Otherwise, we would not be on these MCA stages. So it was a very learning experience for me, like disciplinary as well. And it wasn't just like a fun taiko thing, but it kind of went to this like deep philosophical place for me. So I like that.
That's amazing. I really, really love that connection from art form to just like mind and body. So
yeah, totally. Yeah.
So I think also the beauty of the things, it's not just us, but I think many taiko group, but I would only know about us, but they are, majority of the members are community members. And it's led, what's different about us is it's led by professionals. So, you know, the professional artists and performing artists and musicians are leading this group and bringing these community members to the really, really demanding performing art. And they execute them. And we can, you know, we have a little bit of an older group called Cool Ladies. I don't know if you have seen them. Yeah, they're older ladies that we have, and they execute very, very complicated song. And you know, it's once again, it's a community member and embracing into this high caliber art. And, you know, I'm always excited to bring those people into the higher art and have them experience what it's like to have the art of taiko, you know. Because a lot of times this art of taiko has been misused by other people, you know. And I get into heavy argument about this, you know, philosophy. So, but, you know, art is there. And yeah. So Sarah-san, we're going to talk about June soon.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, and, yes.
Yeah, mm-hmm. June is part of our drumming choir. You see, actually, you saw him three times on the video today.
Right? Yeah, he was there.
Okay.
So June and I know each other for a long time too, and he's been a long time friend. And I am so glad that June stayed with us for this long. Wouldn't you say, Yotun Kiyomi?
Yeah.
Having a job, full time job, operating the club. He owns the two clubs, you know. But first time I met June was that we used to have a ceramic store in Chicago.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, you didn't know that. So we were selling this our product in the market, and I needed to take care of sales on our ceramic goods. And I found June because he was a student at the time, and then he helped me with our market selling. Then I got to know him. Since then, I found out he's a drummer, he's a percussionist, so we did the project together since then. Then he came to Tsukasa Taiko, and he's been with us for so many years, and we're really honored that he still come to play with us, you know, with his busy schedule. Because, you know, his schedule is like flipped over, so he works until like 5 a.m. or something, right?
You know, it's really funny, and we'll welcome in June Takanarita in a moment, so you all can know who we're talking about in spirit right now. But I was thinking earlier the irony that, so I've known Tatsu and Tsukasa Taiko for many years, and then there was a community member at the center, at the Japanese Culture Center, Van Pogum, who is a DJ who does city pop, which is really from the same decade that you're kind of talking about in some ways, talking about the 70s in Japan. And I thought, you know, the best place for Van to really feel this vibe in Chicago is right at Murasaki Sake Lounge. So I took Van to Murasaki and talk to June. So somehow we're all back here full circle because Van DJs at Murasaki, and somehow all of us, and Van will be DJing again at the end of the night tonight. Mm-hmm. So somehow this is all this big full circle of people into Japanese music in Chicago. So I really love
it. I think that means, Sarah-san, that means we are bound to be together to begin with. It's a karma. So
Agreed. Before we bring June in, let's take a small break, and then when we come back, we'll have June from Murasaki Sake Lounge to chat a bit more. So everybody, just hang with us for just a moment. Let me see. Okay. Let's see. There we go. All right. So we are back. We're back with June and a few others from the Murasaki Sake Lounge. If you don't mind saying hello to everybody. Konnichiwa.
Konnichiwa.
Also, on the everyone's wearing a mask there, but on the far left, is it for us? Make sure. But June, raise your hand if you can. You're so masked. Yeah. Okay. So we just hyped up June a whole bunch at the end of our last show as a member of the Tsukasa Taiko group, and also is the owner of Murasaki Sake Lounge, and is also a musician and kind of does a million things as well. So we just were really so jazzed to introduce this place, which I can only speak for myself, but this is truly my favorite bar, lounge, place to be in Chicago. I call it the purple place because it's so purple all over. Mm. And that we named Murasaki. So, oh, it says they lost sound. Uh-oh.
We lost sound? Interesting. They can't hear you. Oh, so bizarre. Can you hear me still, chat? I'm probably just going to refresh it. And
I can leave and come back.
We should be okay. Let's see. Let me push over to BRB. We can't hear anyone for now. Okay. Oh, that's crazy. This has been giving us the test of time. Let's see. And hey, check. Can you hear us okay now?
Can you hear us? Mosh moshi, konbanwa. Say no.
No.
Can you hear anybody? Oh, I get it. We have one yes.
I have a yes, and we have a nope. That's a tough one. I don't know.
Now we think it might just be unglued. Maybe it's just you.
Okay, let me check my end.
But we want you to know that we are here for it. If you can't hear, we will figure it out. No, they aren't talking right now.
Okay.
Well, did you all not be able to hear us at all last time? Because I'll make sure to reintroduce all of this crew in the bottom again. Maybe I'll just do it anyway. Okay, so just a note, before we kind of wrapped and had this weird purgatory of no sound, we were talking about Jun Takanarita, who is part of the Taiko group, and Tatsu and crew were talking him up quite a bit. That's because they aren't talking yet, so no big deal. But that being said, Jun is here with us now from Murasaki Sake Lounge, and Murasaki Sake Lounge is downtown Chicago. And like I was saying, it's one of my favorite places. I call it the purple place because it's so purple inside, and it's also called Murasaki, so that would kind of align. And June is the owner of Murasaki Sake Lounge, and also a drummer and a musician, and kind of an all-around amazing person as well. So we're just so grateful to have them with us tonight on Tokyo House Party. We actually really wanted to do our party live from Murasaki Sake Lounge because we love it there, but it's obviously too difficult, and maybe in the future, you never know. But enough from me. Would you all at Murasaki like to tell us a little bit more about Murasaki and yourselves?
Yeah, he's going to explain. So Yuki, our bartender, he's going
to explain. Hi, guys. This is Yuki from Murasaki Sake Lounge. I'm a bartender here at Murasaki. Murasaki is one and only Japanese-owned sake lounge in Chicago. We have over 100 different kinds of sake, Japanese whiskey, and spirits. We also serve food, which is excellent for pairing with our drinks. We also try to host events as many as possible throughout the months. Before the pandemic, we had DJs spinning every weekend. We do sake tasting events, musical performances, Murasaki is avid with connecting with local artists, DJs, musicians, and especially anything associated with Japanese culture. We were closed after the lockdown was announced due to COVID-19, obviously. But we are happy to announce that we are now back in business with a limited occupancy. We are following the strict guidelines for bars and restaurants that are issued by City of Chicago. Constantly sanitizing and ventilating air regularly to provide an environment that customers can feel safe. We also started delivering. We also started a delivery service. We can deliver Japanese groceries, pastries, alcohol, food. For more details, please check our official website. We're located in Streeterville, downtown Chicago, 211 East Ontario, 211 East Ontario, and we're open from Monday through Sunday, from 5 p.m. to 12 a.m. And if you guys have any questions, my boss, Jun, will answer for you guys.
So, Jun and Yuki, could you tell us how long Murasaki has been in Chicago, and have you always been the person who's run it?
Oh, it's been here for more than 30 years.
Yeah.
We used to name called the Cafecino. The previous owner just retired like 6-7 years ago, and I took over. I've been working here for 12 years, and he's been working here for 12 years too, I think.
I was working here before him, actually.
Yeah.
So I'm technically, he's older than me, but I'm his senpai.
That's funny, yeah. And I feel like you're all musicians there, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, so you're a community of musicians working at Murasaki.
Yes. Some of our hostess girls are musicians, too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. A lot of artists work here.
Yeah. Does everybody at among the musicians, I know there was taiko, but what other instruments or arts do the rest of you flourish in? What does everybody else do?
I do music production. I actually work for Chicago Public School, and I also work for After School Matters. I produce music, and I sometimes DJ at Murasaki. We don't have any other musician people here right now, but we have jazz pianists, classical flutists, girls.
There was I remember some years ago I went, I may have been there by myself late at night, who knows, that may have been me, but there was a person working the bar who played violin too, and they were like, oh, well, I'm happy to play violin for you sometime. And I was like, wow, this is amazing. The best place.
That's pretty. Speaking of some of your DJs in the events, I've personally been there a couple times. This is one of my favorite places to go to. And this was also paired with getting to see Van Pogum DJ some of the City Pop evenings at your lounge. It's my understanding that you have some upcoming events, one of which includes Van. Is that correct?
Yes, next week. Next Saturday, we'll have a City Pop event.
Okay, great. And is this going to still be, I assume it's still going to have the limited occupancy, but Van will be spinning for most of the evening?
It's online reservation only so far?
We have two time slot. And the first one is 6 to 8, and the second one is 8:30 to 10:30. And 8:30... Slot is already sold out.
Wow.
And we only have like a 4 spots available for the 6 p.m.
Wow. Yeah.
Not surprised. Yeah. You all are very popular.
Very popular. Yes.
And it's funny, another show we'll be talking about Suntory a little bit, but I know that you all carry Nika. And I wonder, Nika is kind of the underdog, in my opinion, an underappreciated whiskey from Japan. And you guys have such a great selection of it. I wonder if any of you could tell us a little bit about Nika. Taketsuru, Nika Taketsuru is one of my favorites. And it's just something I found at a konbini, and I had no idea how great it would be.
Oh, Actually, the name Taketsuru is a person who actually started a whiskey scene in Japan. Taketsuru 21. It's actually named the person who started the whiskey scene in Japan. That's his face. I'm not sure you guys can see it.
Oh, yeah.
All the Japanese whiskey companies, they like even the makers of Iwai, they all came from the same umbrella. They all studied whiskey making from Taketsuru. Taketsuru, he studied how to make whiskey in Ireland. Technically speaking, a lot of Japanese whiskeys are scotch, actually. The method of making scotch different, what makes it different from other whiskey is when you dried grains, you use peat coal to smoke it. If it's a Canadian whiskey, bourbon, usually people leave it out in the sun and let it dry naturally. But Scotch whiskey and Japanese whiskey, they smoke the grain by smoking it using a peat coal. And Taketsuru learned how to make Scotch whiskey in Ireland. And he started a whiskey distillery in Hokkaido. Hokkaido is a top of Japan, the northern part of Japan, because latitude is the closest to Ireland. So the weather, and Yoichi is actually, this is my personal favorite whiskey. I actually don't want that many people to know about this whiskey, but they actually distill this whiskey at the original Hokkaido distillery. So if you want to taste the original whiskey, Japanese whiskey, Yoichi is the one that you can.
I think we do. I think that's a yes out there.
Nomitai. Yeah, next time.
We have a lot of Nikka whiskey. And not only whiskey, Nikka also started to make gin and vodka as well. So it's not just whiskey. They have other stuff too.
That's great. And Yuki, I think you all do, you have karaoke rooms there too, is that right?
Yeah, we have here. Oh,
the gins.
Oh. You brought the...
I love their packaging too. Oh, okay. I really love their design. Mm-hmm. I love it.
Yeah, it's really modern.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we have a karaoke room. We only got one room. Is this still 40, 35? An hour?
Yeah, for weekdays.
Weekdays, it's going to be $35 an hour. It's minimum order of one drink per person per hour.
Mm-hmm.
And you can make a reservation for 2 hours. And if there's nobody wants to do a karaoke after the person, then you can extend 3 hours, 4 hours. But
yeah,
when you make the reservation, it's 2 hours is a max.
I love it. And that's one of my favorite memories of Murasake is I can be there and checking out Van, who is DJing behind you over there. But then I can also hear people yelling from the karaoke room.
Yeah.
Singing entirely off key sometimes, and you could just get the whole vibe.
Right.
That's great.
Yeah. Is there anything else that you guys have coming up that you want to maybe let everyone know about? Or?
Not anything, we don't have anything set in stone, but we are planning to have more musical events and more maybe tasting events. So more coming up.
Great. Okay. Yeah. And the link to Murasake Sake Lounge is in our chat. So you can go check out their website. They also have social media and such. And you can probably find, I feel like Yuki, I almost always see you there. And same as June. So any night you do end up popping in when things feel safe for you, I'm sure you can make some new friends quickly.
Yep.
Definitely.
Yep. If you, if you, the people at this event, if you see me, say hi. Yeah, please feel free to say hi. If you want any recommendation, I'm more than happy to help you guys. So.
Yeah. Great. Gosh, I feel like we should have you all on a whole nother show. You can just tell us about all of your favorite whiskeys and then also about the music you're producing. And it's just everyone's so interesting.
Yeah, I agree. With that said, before we switch things around just a little bit more, I believe we're going to bring Tatsu back in for a little bit to chat with everyone from Murasaki. And then we'll have roughly, I would want to say, you know, 20 or so minutes, maybe 25 minutes before Van will be going live again. But before we bring Tatsu back in, I wanted to thank you, Yuki and June, for telling us about the upcoming events at Murasake. I'm very much looking forward to it. Like, hontoni tanoshimi. I hope I can get back over to Murasake soon and try some of these whiskey recommendations. So, arigatou gozaimasu.
Arigatou gozaimashita.
Let's get Tatsu back in here. I'm going to do a little bit of adjusting. Let's see here. All righty.
Yeah, for anyone else, while we're just hanging, I should note that Murasake is so great. It feels like if you've ever been to Japan and you go to a bar that's kind of below a building or in some, you know, this is, it really feels like you're in Japan when you step mm-hmm. inside. And just walking up, it feels just like being in a bar in Japan. And if you want 21, wait, but you know, whatever you can check
yes.
it out.
Yes, absolutely. Welcome back, Tatsu.
Thank you. I have to say something more about the Murasaki Lounge. It's a greatest place to hang out, you know.
Yeah.
Like my a lot of times late at night, we would finish okeiko or something and let's go eat ramen, have a little drink, you know. Mm-hmm. And a lot of izakaya places already closed by 10:30 or so. Murasaki is open, and in spite of the fact they're not izakaya, but they have a really great food. Mm-hmm. And I recommend a lot of people that they have one of the best shoyu ramen in the city at night.
Mm.
And that's the only place that they can, you know. I am really, really against putting everything, the sesame seed in everything, because that's a big mistake. You know, you go to Japan and eat the ramen, and the only few kind of ramen will have a goma on there.
Yeah.
And we don't put the goma on everything else. But in here, I think goma, the sesame seeds, is an icon of Asian food. So they like to put the goma on everything. And, you know, like every ramen places I go to, they have a goma on it. And I usually have to say, like, no goma on my miso ramen, please. Don't. No, blah, 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 blah. You know,
I can't unknow this now, Tatsu. Every time I see goma on my food, I'm going to think of you now.
Yeah. Because I think goma is great, but we don't put, see, Japanese food, Japanese izakaya food, we don't put the goma on everything.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I am really, really against that. It's like not every taiko player are naked, man. I like to, you know, it's the same thing. But Murasaki Lounge have a best otsumami.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So they have yaki onigiri, who's good. I don't know if people know about the yaki onigiri. It's a rice ball. It's fried, burnt on the pan, so that the surface of the both side of the onigiri has a little, you know.
Oh yeah,
some of my favorites. Yeah,
that's so good. They have a great takoyaki in there, and my favorite is the octopus, little octopus otsumami they have, and it's great. And of course the drink, the shochu, the coffee shochu. I always drink coffee shochu when I go to Murasaki. They have the best coffee shochu.
Gosh, I'm feeling very natsukashi. We could all.
Yeah.
I would go to Murasaki quite often. I think last year I had a birthday party there. We love going there, I will say, if you ever go there in a night that Van is DJing, though, just come prepared to maybe not get in, because it's so popular. It's such an intimate space, so if you can kind of get in, it's really lovely. And just like Tatsu said, there's a great bar. It's a great place just to hang out. It's really set up so you can just have like conversations, and it's not really a place where you have to feel like you're bombarded with people. It's very intimate and sincere. It's mm-hmm. great.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yes. And you know, he owns another place in the suburb too, you know, so mm-hmm. maybe someday you want to introduce the other one.
I've never been there, so yeah.
I performed with my trio in there couple times, more than a couple times actually, and it's a nice cozy place too. And they also have a different sets of a food, and apparently June's very very good cook at home too. Right? I don't, you know. So
should I mention the name of the bar? Maybe.
Yeah.
Summertime Jazz Cafe and Lounge. It's located Mount Prospect.
That's great.
Yep. And we got actually a good cook during the COVID-19. So we have much better food right now. If you reserve the bar, we can serve the sashimi, sushi, and anything.
And you also do the takeout service, right? The curb pickup or something?
For of course.
You? Yeah.
Jin-san, what suburb is it in? We have someone asking.
Mount Prospect.
Mount Prospect. Okay.
Yes. Yep. Go there. That's great.
And we have
Tarako spaghetti.
Mentaiko
spaghetti ga oishii in desu.
I don't know if I've even had that in the United States ever. So that's cool.
Yeah. Yep. Only in summertime cafe.
And does it have this great sake menu as well?
Yes, but not like Murasaki, because we have 100 here. we are getting more sake now.
So like I said, we are very grateful. He's always busy running two different places and still with us with Tsukasa Taiko for so many years. And a lot of we have a lot of school visit during the weekdays to visit school. And Jun comes with us in the morning. So he probably goes home at 6 a.m. and comes to school with us at 9 a.m. But I tell June that was my life when I was his age, playing in the club until 3 a.m. in the morning and hang out and do stuff and get up at 9, go to.
Well, I'm sure the schools appreciate it so much. I can't imagine. I mean, I know a lot of schools are looking for some of these cultural experiences and to open their worlds a little bit. And you all being here to serve that role is just so invaluable. So
yes, and I think like your organization, we're about letting them know about the Japanese culture.
Mm.
So we want to inform them about what's happening. Mm.
Right. That's great. That's great. On any amount of sleep, that's great.
I agree. I wanted to propose using the rest of this time to maybe having a bit of a watch party with some of the other videos that you provided, Tatsu, and allow our viewers to be able to see some of these other things that they're not only taiko, but maybe even some of the shamisen or avant-garde jazz.
Sure. You can play any of this and, we'll watch a little bit and we'll talk about it.
Yeah. Yeah. That's great. If you're up for it, I would love to play the rest of Suri because we unfortunately had to pause and it was really amazing to be able to get to see the rest of that. And so viewers at home, just give us half a second here to get that up for you and then we'll get that rolling again.
Great.
Let me see.
And as always, if you want to chime in and tell us that something's wrong, we're here for that. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for all of the help throughout this stream. I can't even put it to words at the moment because I've been so surprised at how many weird technical things that have occurred from somebody, being heard to not being heard to links not working.
It creates the drama, Derek. Yeah. this is a live stream thing. Anything could happen.
Yeah.
And listen, don't leave yet. I'm seeing some thank yous to our guests, which we are already will thank you up front. But we aren't going anywhere. Neither are they. So they will be back to answer a few more questions and tell you about what's on the horizon. So.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay. Performance Suji that we saw a bit of earlier, there is about, I would say, 6.5 minutes left, 7 minutes left, which I'm going to play the rest of for you now. So here we go.
Great.
All right. Wow.
I'm so glad we got to watch the rest of that. And we would have missed out on all of that. So this was, I'm glad we got a chance to bounce back. Tatsu, I feel like if you're open to it, we have 15 minutes left. And it would be awesome to hear about what kinds of things you have coming up and what kinds of things you're doing right now.
Well, right now, a lot of the focus on is how we can present our musical activity online. Mm-hmm. So Asian Improv Arts have online streaming program about 4 or 5 times a month. So we either focus on our dance program or taiko program or our contemporary music program. So they all have something to do with the tsukasa taiko anyway. So if I would do the jazz kind of things and taiko, like in the Miyumi project, is part of it. We have a Tuesday on Terrace, which a series that we always do at the Museum of Contemporary Art during the summer. Now it's on online and the radio. So I've already submitted our most recent live recording of the Miyumi project in there. Obihiro, Chicago, the Shiko Kairo is going on at the Hairpin Arts Center. You can physically go visit the gallery to make an appointment. Also live streaming next weekend. I think the artist talk of 5 different artists there, followed by a performance of Elastics and the Tokyo.
Wow.
Yeah. And Shubukai, our dance program, also have a streaming program coming up. I think it's also next week. And we're kind of focusing on how we can maintain our integrity, artistic and musical integrity, wow, into this very uncertain pandemic COVID-19 time, and you know, see what we can do with it. And you know, our releases of my albums, my new albums are coming out on vinyl this time. So Miyumi Project is coming out from the as a vinyl double disc. My 25-year plus of musical endeavor. It's one of the first Afro-Asian or Asian-Afro collaborative music in Chicago, you know, that we lasted for a long time. I'm so glad that a label picked it up as a best of Miyumi project.
And Tatsu, I wonder, actually, just to be clear for myself and others, yeah, what exactly is the Miyumi project?
Okay, so I have 3 children. Kyoto is one of the oldest one that who's been talking to us today, with us today. And Eigen is the middle son. And the Miyumi is the youngest daughter. She's in Kyoto right now, studying abroad. And so as an immigrant, going back to the story of the immigrant, when you migrate to America, the first generation, which is me, I'm a Shin Issei, so you know, I came into Chicago post-war during the 70s. And when you start to have a family, the first generation parents always think that your kids who are born in here are just as same as the Japanese in Japan. Right? They want to believe that. And I did too, right? So, but then again, you spend time with your kids, and you know, we raise all of our kids bilingual, so they speak Japanese, and you know, they can communicate with the Nihongo and everything. But then again, they have this American life. They grew up here, right? So it's a Japanese American, Asian American life. But the parents usually continue to want to say, like, no, my daughter is a Japanese, my son is Japanese, and they are. But they're also American, right? So in the immigration, I would say the prejudiceness about the first generation immigration is this idea of Americanize is very negative conclusion after you migrate, because you have this like, oh, it's Americanized, my kid, it's terrible, right? So it takes a while for parents to understand it's okay to be American. it's okay to be Asian American. It's okay to be Japanese American. And it took me a while for me as an artist to playing all this music and doing the performing arts and everything to finally understand, like, well, yeah, I mean, I myself is also part of the new Japanese American community, you know? So that's, then when Miyubi was born, that's the time I realized, wow, my third child, I really have to be a part of the Asian American, Japanese American community. So mm-hmm. I named the band Miyubi.
Oh, that's really lovely. And that really makes a lot of sense now that I have that context. That's really lovely. I had no idea. So thank you for all those.
Right, because each of my child, Kyoto has her own. I made one album called Kyoto when she was born. And my son was born 3 years after that, and I made another album called Eigen. And so the Kyoto album was released when she was born. Eigen was released when Eigen was born. And when Miyumi was born, I instead of releasing the Miyumi album, I made that band as a Miyumi project.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And who was in the band?
Yeah, so yes, I named the band after Miyumi, yes. Mm-hmm.
Who makes up this band?
You're breaking up on my ear.
Oh. Maybe we'll mute these guys that just kind of returned to us. Tatsu, I'm wondering if you could let everyone know who's in the Miyumi project, like who's in the band.
Okay, right now the current Miyumi project is myself, Muwata Bowden from AICM, and Edward Wilkerson from AICM, and Abriel Ra, who's playing the drum, and Coco Elises playing conga. Abriel plays the drum, Jamie Kempker on cello, and Kyoto, and sometimes Kiyomi, and Noriko, and some other Tsukasa Taiko members to join.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and sometimes I have a guitar player in there too. Rami Atachi is a guitar player. So three horns, one cello, or two horns, one cello, and conga, drums, and the taiko.
Cool.
So very drum-heavy band.
Mm.
Wow. Cool. Yeah. Speaking of, we do have Kyoto and Kiyomi, who's joined us again.
Right.
And let's bring him in here.
We're back.
Wait. Okay. Okay.
I like this new scene. It's very nice. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I love the background. It's very cool.
So to catch up Kyoto and Kiyomi, we just, Tatsu just kind of ran us through all the new things you all have coming up. And we kind of shared all those a bit and including the things that you're doing at the Hairpin Art Center and how to make appointments and things. But we wanted to make sure that we could kind of hear back from you all before we throw things over to Van. So.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you.
Come visit us at chicagoobihiro.org, but there's one O in the middle. It is in the Twitch chat. I'll put it there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's for our project, an exhibition that's happening at the Hairpin Arts Center. We will also be streaming our live artist talks and panels. And everything related to the that exhibition on our website, on our stream site, which is stream.anw.org. While we're also running our usual Asian Improv Arts / Taiko Legacy online programming.
Yeah, we have a, maybe Tatsu talked about it, but we have a program tomorrow night, actually, at 7 p.m. on stream.anw.org. It is episode 4, I believe, of the ARMW series. It's Tsukasa Taiko's Behind the Curtains of Taiko Legacy. So we kind of touched it a little bit earlier with all the footages that Tokyo House Party has streamed for us,
mm-hmm.
but we're actually going to do a deep dive from the beginning all the way to the end and kind of reveal the hidden secrets, if you will.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
the backstage pass. From yeah.
The show.
Yeah. It's well, I guess
from my dad's notebooks to mm-hmm. the stage.
Wow.
You should note that everyone, if you're following us here on Twitch, they've been chiming in here from their own Twitch account, which you might want to follow so you can kind of get notified when they go live and do all their cool things.
Mm-hmm, yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, yeah. Yes. It's going to be it'll be a really fun one tomorrow. The backstage pass is really something. It kind of works, I think, best virtually because we can, always take you behind the scenes as the chaos is happening, mm-hmm. but you know, it's always going to be hectic. But now that we can, show these things online, we can really sit down and watch the footages and show you all the photos and also give you like an in-depth discussion about, right, like Kyoto said, how it goes from Tatsu's notebook really to the youngest drummers, like, you know, how they learn things and how they learn about the quick costume changes with Hujima Sensei's kimono consulting and featuring up all the guest artists from Japan and also other, you know, grandmasters that we have, like Yoshinojo Hujima, the dancer, and along with Genyu Arts, of course, makes an appearance, you know, because they come back every December to play with us. So it's going to be like a full-length feature, and we will actually also have some of our Gintenkai members join us for the live stream. So they'll be doing like a live Q&A and talking with us and giving their perspective, cool. You know, because obviously, Tsukasa Taiko is more than Hiyomi and Kyoto. We have a lot of these awesome young up-and-coming new generation drummers and performers, and I am sure they're excited to share their two cents too. So we hope you can join us tomorrow 7 p.m. Central Standard at stream.rmw.org.
Cool. I'll be there. I'll be tuning in. Tanoshimi. It's going to be great. We have just a few more minutes left before we transition over to Van. Sarah, do you have any thing that you wanted to add while we have Tatsu-san, Kyoto-san, Kyomi-san all here with us?
Gosh, I've so much, but I don't want to bore you all with how grateful I am to have them all here. And, you know, over the years, it's just been such a joy to work with you all. And you brought so much to our community. And you're doing it still in this time that we're all existing together, and we're just so grateful, and you know, spending the whole night with us, and this has just been great, and we just can't wait to see what you all do next.
Yes,
great.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having us.
Yes.
And we're gonna keep going with what we do virtually for a while, but we will be coming back in the live performances in both all dance, taiko drumming, contemporary art, and visual art. We want to come back to it. And in the meantime, I forgot to mention that we're the only taiko group has a vinyl. See, not many, many taiko group will have a vinyl releases in here.
I want it. So, I want it.
Yeah, same.
Yes, we can. You can buy this on Amazon.com.
DJ Van would like to
and also Tatsu's little Tatsu's pictures is in my shamisen album. So, you know, if you buy this album, it's all the pictures in here. Wow. So
see, that's every penny just for those photos of small Tatsu.
Yes. But I think we really appreciate this opportunity, and also, you know, folks, they are doing very, very important things to introduce contemporary Japanese culture to Chicago. And I've known Sarah for a long time working on a different project. And it's really important to have you guys do this thing.
Well, this is all pretty sad without all of you. So thank you so much. And there's two things I hope we could touch on before we have to say goodbye. One is, we actually have this amazing video that Tatsu shared with us of that vinyl being made, or a new vinyl being made. So it's like that part of Mr. Rogers where you get to see how things are made, and it's just mesmerizing. And also, because we've kind of started this amazing conversation with Tatsu, we've learned of one of Tatsu's secret interests, and we're going to have another show on. And you'll never guess what it is.
I know what it is.
It's my secret. But it's, you know, it all connects together when we talk about it. Yes.
That'll be the amazing moment where it just blows everybody's
yes,
mind.
Everybody, oh my god, yes.
It's gonna blow your mind. It blew my mind when you suggested it. I was just like, oh my gosh. It'll be probably not. We have so many things coming up, but stay tuned. We'll announce it kind of soon. I'm sure you all will come for this one. It'll be really cool. So
yep. I'll kind of end things with the video because it's only a minute, and then I'll for you all who are in the chat, I'll probably take things down to just BRB, and then we'll slowly transition into Van's DJ set for the rest of the evening, which is being hosted on his channel. So we'll kind of redirect you over there. One other update is something a little bit different from Tokyo House Party. For those of you who are familiar with the Twitch environment, that of course it originated as a space for video games and expanded to be able to host these conversations like we're having now. And so next week, a very cool game by the name of Ghost of Tsushima is going to be releasing. It is a samurai game. It is pulling a lot of inspiration from Akira Kurosawa films. We are going to be playing that game. We're not going to be playing the game on Tokyo House Party. We'd like to keep that space as to what it is so that we don't segment this channel into too many features and different topics. And so where you can find us playing Ghost of Tsushima as well as a few other things will be on, that'll actually be on my Twitch channel called Waking Oni. And so let me put the link there for you all.
To be clear, I will be playing this game because I'm terrible at video games. However, I will be there to be awed and amazed at how historically relevant this game is. So I'm very jazzed.
Yep. What Waking Oni is my Twitch channel where normally I will. I just kind of relaunched it in anticipation of Ghost of Tsushima coming out. All my channel is dedicated to not only sharing a bit of game development for games that have where I explore the intersection between African American and Japanese culture, specifically with the title that I'm working on currently and a new one in the future, but I'll be playing some games for the latter half of that portion, and so that is every Monday night, but we'll be shooting things off on Friday for Ghost of Tsushima. Thanks again to our viewers at home. Thank you, Tatsu-san, Kyoto-san, Kiyomi-san, for...
No, arigato
gozaimasu. In June, if you're still listening, arigato gozaimasu. We appreciate you for coming on and chatting with us.
And I will see you in September for my secret other style. Yes.
The mystery.
Yes. But, I mean, really I really great. Can't hype this enough. It's going to be really unexpected and awesome. So.
Yeah. Chat, we really hope you enjoyed and we hope you enjoy a little bit of how it's made with this vinyl video to end things off. So we hope to see you again in 2 weeks for another episode of Tokyo House Party. See y'all later.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mata.
Oyasumi.
Party on.
We'll see you at the party.